grace and peace from God our Creator, hope in our Redeemer Jesus the Christ, and the promised gifts of the Holy Spirit are with you always.
Amen.
Well, here we are again this week reading a story about Jesus that we've probably heard a million times, and maybe even more in our popular culture than in church, right? When we encounter someone who is really impressive and we think can do no wrong, we might say that that person walks on water, right? They're just that good. This phrase can even make its way into the pejorative when someone receives high praise that we think is undeserved. Oh, well, she walks on water around there, right? It can be hard to imagine a time before phrases like this were so embedded in our vernacular, let alone being witnesses to the event that coined the phrase. The disciples, of course, our usual suspects, are, as usual, terrified. They're in their boat, far from shore, battered by the waves, the text says. The wind was against them. They're fishermen, so they know their way around a boat. But weather is unpredictable. They've been out in the water overnight, and they're probably exhausted. So when Jesus comes walking toward them on the surface of the water, they are, unsurprisingly, frightened. It's a ghost, they shout. Jesus immediately realizes that his sudden appearance has not comforted them, but terrified them further. He says, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." There are a lot of words in the Bible, and a lot of them are quotable. And I love none of them quite like I love these. Do not be afraid. We live in a big world with a lot going on, and a lot we can find ourselves afraid of. We are afraid of change, and we are afraid of instability, and we are afraid of loneliness, and we are afraid of any number of things, external and internal. Even in the middle of his fear of the storm going on around him, Peter stands up and challenges Jesus, saying, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come out on the water." This is a fascinating challenge, because it assumes that Jesus can control this environment so specifically that he can ensure that Peter too can walk on the sea. But it also requires Peter to take that step out of the boat. Not knowing if Jesus is who he says he is, Peter takes that step. You've read ahead to the part where he doubts and sinks, but we're just going to put that aside for a minute. As I stand before you this morning, August 13th, we are 13 days away from the official move-in date of the new cohort of volunteers for our year-long service corps program, the Lutheran Episcopal Volunteer Network. This year's Loveneers are coming to us live from across the nation: New York, Virginia, Indiana, Georgia, and of course, the great state of California. These young adults have graduated from college, an inspiring feat in and of itself, and have made the choice to spend the next 11 months of their lives living in intentional Christian community and serving in nonprofit organizations in a city they've never set foot in before. Talk about stepping out of the boat. They're coming to us for an opportunity to learn and grow and be transformed by their service and their witness in the community. They're able to do this in part because of support from congregations and people like yourselves, who dedicate an entire month of your year to turning your year-long support into direct financial support as your monthly ministry partner. You also support them with your prayers and with your welcome when they worship here, and with your encouragement throughout their service in your community. Thank you for helping to create the space for Leaven to thrive. During the application and interview process this year, I noticed something a little different than I'd seen in past years. I always ask them why they're considering a year of service, and they often say things like, "I was raised to always give back," or "I'm considering becoming a social worker and I want to see more about what that's like." Or, "My campus pastor suggested that I spend a year reflecting on the connections between my faith and my work in the world." Or, "My sister did it, and she told me I should do it too." These are all excellent reasons, and it's wonderful for all of these folks to be in this together. This year, though, I spoke to more than a few young adults who said that the state of the world, and our nation in particular, had given them pause as they contemplated life after college. They were less interested in going out into the workforce to be a cog in a wheel that didn't mean anything to them. And they wanted to do something meaningful to make life better for other people. These young people are hearing the gospel and doing something about it. They don't know what they're getting into, but they're getting into it. As we embark on this new 11 program year, I will remind them not to be afraid. It's going to be a year full of unknowns, starting with the housemates they're about to share it with. The service that they'll do will introduce them to many of the poorest and least resourced members of our society. Facing those realities on a daily basis will not be easy, and they will be afraid sometimes. Outside of that, they will be participants in their wider, messy world. Thank you for being part of providing the infrastructure that sets up these young adults to ask hard questions and face tough truths, to rewire old habits and rethink old frameworks. We know this will not be a walk in the park. "Take heart, it is I," Jesus will say. "Do not be afraid." I will admit to you, dear ones, that this week, I was afraid. On Tuesday, the President of the United States and the Chairman of North Korea hurled threats at one another, insinuating that they might hurl nuclear weapons next. I don't think that y'all need to be reminded that I'm only 29 years old, and therefore have not experienced true nuclear anxiety in my lifetime. You may recall the Cuban Missile Crisis and the Cold War, and maybe have been recalling those days in these days. Perhaps you recall duck and cover drills in school or the underground bunker building fever. Perhaps because you recall those things, you were a little afraid this week too. And in another callback to what we would like to believe is ancient history, white supremacists marched on the University of Virginia on Friday night, and throughout Charlottesville, Virginia, in their Unite the Right rally yesterday. I watched live online as men carried torches and chanted, not unlike footage of the Klan I've seen in documentaries about the civil rights movement. But I also watched videos of the sanctuary of St. Paul's Church in Charlottesville, Virginia, where clergy from around the country sang and prayed and prepared to protest that same rally the next day. They sang "O Freedom" and "Wade in the Water" and other old spirituals ripe with eternal resonance, and blessed each other for the hard work of witness. And then on Saturday, they too took to the streets. They linked arms and stood firmly in the way of armed militiamen. They proclaimed loudly that Black Lives Matter, and that love trumps hate, and that God is not a white supremacist, and that bigotry and hatred do not have the final word. I bet many of them shook in fear. But they clung to each other and to their faith in the risen Lord Jesus the Christ. And again, they sang. I don't know what they sang, but soon we are going to sing. "No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since Christ is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing. For some of us, it is dumbfounding that we are witnessing the violent extremism of white supremacist terrorism in 2017. We do not understand how the nation we believe stands for freedom and justice for all has been overrun by those who think freedom is just for some. We watch in horror as our fellow Americans are beaten and bloodied as they stand up for justice. And we struggle to wrap our minds around the idea that our fellow Americans are doing the beating and the bloodying. For most people of color in the United States, this is not news and it is not shocking. For centuries, they have witnessed violence against their neighbors by their neighbors, and we have ignored those cries. Many of us wish that we could ignore this. Many of us wish we could turn off the news and that the events would simultaneously vanish. Many of us wish we did not have to reckon with the reality this has presented for our society. Many of us wish we were not accountable to one another quite so literally. That would be less scary. But we do not have that privilege, dear friends. We are the body of Christ. St. Teresa of Avila said, "Christ has no body on earth but yours. No hands, no feet but yours. Yours are the eyes with which he looks compassion on this world. Yours are the feet with which he walks to do good." Not every one of us is called to be there on those front lines, arm in arm. Some of us are and should go. Others of us are called to pray, to lament, to support, to tend, to weep, to speak, to sin. We are called to confront the ways in which the sin of white supremacy has infiltrated our communities in subtler ways than those torch-wielding mobs. All of us, as the body of Christ in the world, are called to band together in solidarity with any and all who are marginalized and trampled upon. All of us, as the body of Christ, are called to denounce violence in all its forms, to disavow bigotry wherever it rears its head, and to listen to Jesus who says, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid."